what really interests me in my research now is what we call legal tech, legal technology, which is the application of what we could call AI, but is not really AI, to legal context, whether it's the business of law, administration of law, scheduling, research. But what happens on the business side is less concerning or interesting to me as a researcher compared to what happens on the public-facing side. That's what really interests me. Estonia, I was there a couple weeks ago, has announced plans to use what they call a robot judge to help resolve small claims cases under 7,000 euro. But the problem is that the legal concepts and ideas that are involved in a 7,000 euro case are no different to those involved in a 7 billion euro case. So part of my argument when I was there was to say, like, I understand that you want to use a low-risk environment, but to somebody, 7,000 euro might be their life savings. So I think that there's real problems with this idea that computation, algorithms, what we call AI, could replace human decision-making. I think that's very dangerous. What I see it doing is helping judges make better decisions, but I think that a lot of thought has to be put in how to do that, so that we don't end up with people just deferring to what the machine says. So what my research focuses on now is how far can we take this idea? The idea that I'm specifically pushing back against is a colleague of mine from the University of Toronto, Ben Allery. He has this concept called the legal singularity. And he talks about how sustained increases in machine learning, compute power, and data storage will basically allow machines to replace the function of the legal system, and we will end up in what he calls this sort of perpetual state of equilibrium. And I think that this is it's a bold vision, but I'm concerned about what the world would look like if it worked. Because I think what it would do would diminish the capacity for individuals, judges, to exercise human discretion, have empathy, pathos for people, and really make individualized decisions as opposed to machine learning, which would just over time create a very fixed concept of something like reasonableness in law or fair use. Creativity is central to what judges do, and preserving that autonomy to allow humans to do that is very important. It's really easy to be cynical about technology, especially lawyers. So we talk about AI taking people's jobs. Nobody will miss lawyers. Shakespeare wrote many years ago, the first thing let's do, let's hang all the lawyers. So one of the problems we face as a profession is that we haven't really made our case to the people as to why we play an important role in society, because maybe we've done a really bad job of playing that role. So what I would like to do through my research and talks like this is to try and encourage the use of AI as a complement to what lawyers do and not replace them, but allow them to recapture their role as counselors, where they can work with people to resolve problems as opposed to just treating people like a process. Well, it means whatever we allow it to mean. One of the things that I really resist is this feeling of inevitability about technology. It really struck me that, you know, my students starting this year were born in the 21st century. It's crazy. But they've lived at a time where they've never known anything but the internet. So I call myself an elder millennial in that I remember a time before the internet. So I kind of feel a duty to help them remember that there was a sort of way to live without being always connected. But what AI means for law? Well, I mean, on the business side, I hope it will help firms be better, quicker with what they do, be able to meet the needs of clients better. I hope that, like many of the legal technology companies out there, stay true to their word and improve access to justice. They lower the cost for ordinary people to get legal advice, but I don't want that legal advice to be a machine. It might have a computational aspect to it, but people need people. I think that the role of a lawyer really is as a counselor. That's what it grew out of. So the future, as I hope it develops, is one where we do not surrender our role as decision makers, but we find a way to have machines and AI, whatever it is, be complementary to what we do and basically help us be better at being ourselves. I don't think so. So right now, by the computing paradigm that we are operating in, the machine learning, deep learning paradigm, they're both ways of using historical information to apply it to the present. What it cannot do is what judges do, which is create something where no information exists and apply it to a new situation. Law is not just rules. Sometimes the law isn't clear. Sometimes we disagree on what the correct interpretation is, and sometimes there's no rule. So some of the most important evolutionary steps, and at least in common law tradition, which I'm most familiar with, are things that require judges to say, there's something wrong here. This should not be. We need a concept to fill this void. My favorite example from English common law is a case called Donahue versus Stevenson. This is a case we teach all of our first year law students. It involves a ginger beer manufacturer. A woman drank a bottle of this ginger beer in Scotland. There was a slug inside of it, and she got very, very violently sick. So this was in 1856, I believe, went to court. And what came out of this one case is the concept of, well, manufacturer's liability. We call it the neighbor principle, the idea that if you are manufacturing something for the public, well, you have a duty not to hurt them. We consider this to be self-evident now, but at some point in history, someone had to create this concept. That is what human intelligence is very, very good at, and machines, if we can call them creative at all, cannot do that. They cannot make inferences from information that is not there. That is the role, at least for now, of what judges do, what lawyers do, and preserving that element of human discretion and decision making, not just in law, mortgage applications, job applications, having that human in the loop is, I think, essential. Because it's so easy to be cynical about people and how bad we are at making decisions, how limited we are in our rationality. But you have to have, I believe, faith in our capacity to improve ourselves and our processes. Maybe technology will help us do this, but I draw the line at saying, we can't do this, the machines will have to do it for us. China already has three fully online internet courts to handle a massive backlog of internet-related cases, online transactions. So they are miles ahead. But China can also do things at a scale and speed that most other countries can't. But the basic idea that Estonia is trialing is being explored in a lot of jurisdictions. Certainly in the UK, we're investigating it. And this is not to say there's no case for algorithmic decision-making in law. Ombudsman decisions, fine. In the UK, we now have no-fault divorces. This seems like another area. But I think the biggest question, and the one that I think, the one that I encourage all the people developing these tools and systems to really ask themselves is, what problem are you solving? Are you problematizing something so you can sell a solution? It's not the same thing as problem solving. So the conversation I want to have, what my book Lex Ex Machina is about, the conference I'm hosting later this year in Cambridge is about, is how do we draw these lines? Where in life, for overarching human rights reasons, or simply because we find it creepy, what context do we not want that sort of algorithmic intervention in our lives? And I think that's a conversation that cannot be decided by the people building these things, but the people who are subject to it, which is all of us. You know, one of the most obvious applications of this is what we call predictive policing, the use of, well, algorithmic systems to determine where crime might happen so you can allocate police resources to an area. But the problem is that it never just stops there. So the same system that lets you, on the surface of it, make better policing decisions is a surveillance system, first and foremost. All you have to do is look at what's going on in Western China. in Xinjiang with the Uyghur population. Basically, they are living under mass surveillance and state control by the Chinese state there, where these tools that can be used to help can very quickly be used to hurt. It's a matter of the intention of the people using them that really determines whether they're helpful or hurtful. But there's certainly cases to be made for the use of technology in law enforcement and policing. But it's about applying forethought to the consequences of what you're doing and being realistic as to whether you are actually solving a problem or you are just making it worse by shoehorning in a technological solution to a problem that maybe would be improved by better education, community outreach, investing in people. Technology is rarely the best first option, I find, when it comes to trying to solve social problems. And the mentality, I think, of tech writ large now is that tech-first solutions are the only way to go. And maybe I'm just old-fashioned, and I think that investing in people, investing in communities, investing in education, young people, that's how you build a solid foundation as opposed to just imposing a technological solution on people. So I was given very good advice by someone I respect and admire very dearly to never make predictions about the future unless you want to be proven wrong. You could ask Bill Gates, you know, many years ago he said, I could never envision a future where people would need more than 5 computers. So you got to be careful about predicting the future because there's no science of the future. So what is the future of humanity? Whatever we decide it to be. We create the future through the choices we make today, and technology now transforms our society and ourselves as we make these choices. What I urge to avoid a future of humanity that is very bleak is to really encourage people to maybe spend 6 months more thinking about what you're developing, thinking about the consequences before you launch your product. Because again, this tech-first solutionism to things, I think, is a very, very dangerous impulse. And certainly in the UK, you know, with legal tech, you know, legal tech is only a solution because we didn't fund the justice system in the first place. We cut legal aid, we cut pretty much everything. So if legal tech is a solution, it's a solution to a problem we created. So instead of using a tech-first solution, maybe we should fund these things in the first place, invest in people, invest in communities, invest in institutions. That to me is, I don't know what the future of humanity is, but I think the best path towards a better future is thinking long and hard about what we're doing and the consequences of the choices we make today, because they won't just impact us, they will impact generations. And what we do not want to do is bind other people's options going forward because we today thought this was useful. If we had to put, you know, basically to sum it up, I don't think there's any technology that we've created from the automobile to the atomic bomb where we would not have benefited from saying, maybe we should have spent more time thinking about that. It'd have to be global warming. I mean, the single greatest problem facing all of us is global warming. We all live on this planet. This planet is an ecosystem. The single greatest challenge facing all of us is whether or not we're going to have a planet to live on in 5-10 years time. So I would like to see a sort of re-centralization of all this knowledge and all the skills towards solving these, you know, truly global challenges. That would be first on my list, because without a planet to live on, it doesn't really matter what else happens.